You're tuned in to Greater Refuge Temple, the church in the heart of the city, with the people of the city in its heart.
Thank you for tuning in to the Greater Refuge Temple Church, the church in the heart of the city, with the people of the city in its heart, the church chosen by God for the blessings of the multitude. Where the anointed Bishop Charles Wright Sr. is pastor and Bishop William Wilkins Jr. is our assistant pastor. Join us where service is already in progress.
Praise the Lord and greetings, everyone, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. This service is coming to you from Greater Refuge Temple Church, the church in the heart of the city with the people of the city in its heart, located at 2081 Adam C. Powell Jr. Boulevard, the church in the heart of the city with the people of the city in heart. We ask that you join us in worship as we praise and magnify the Lord in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ.
There's no God like Jehovah.
Come on, y'all.
There's no God like Jehovah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Come on. At the trumpet's call. So lift your voice. It's the year of Jubilee. He's out of Zion too. Salvation. Come on. Hallelujah. We bless your name, O God. Hallelujah.
Even in the midst of this pandemic, we have a lot to praise and thank God for individually. God has been good to us. He's blessed us and brought us thus far. And we magnify his holy and adorable name. As the psalmist would say, Lord, you have been our dwelling place throughout all generations before the mountains were brought forth. Wherever thou hast formed the earth and the world, even from everlasting to everlasting, thou art God. What God has been and who God has been, he's still that. Saving, keeping, blessing, and protecting God. And he will be forevermore. And as I often say, what God has done seals what God will do. If you need a blessing, if you need him to hear your prayer, he will do that. He hears and he answers prayer. And the Apostle John said, we know that God hears our prayers. And if we know that he hears our prayers, we know that we have the petitions that we have desired of him. So in comfort, we face the future. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, in comfort, hallelujah, we pray our prayer of thanksgiving to God at this time. Join with me in prayer in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Oh, dear God, we come before you with thanksgiving. We bless and we praise and we magnify your name. Hallelujah. Look upon the service and bless your children. Everyone that's joined in worship and praise of thee, we thank you for them, Lord. Oh God, they have called unto you and asked us to pray with them and for them, Lord. For the various needs that they have, Lord. Healing for their body. Strength for their lives. Salvation for the unsaved. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Bless your children, each and every one. We need you, Lord God. We can't make it without you, Lord. Comfort your children. Help them to see, oh God, that hallelujah, the best is still yet to come. We give ourselves to you in this worship. Lord, intervene and show thine arms strong. Bless as you've done before. And, oh God, give hope and strength for tomorrow. We give you thanks. We give you praise. And, Lord, we magnify your glorious name. Bless us now as we commit this service, Lord, into the hands, your hands, Lord, your capable hands. Hallelujah. Bless us now. We pray and we ask in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and our God. Let God's children say amen and amen. Thank God for all things in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. By way of announcement, I'd like to announce that the Church of Christ Bible Institute will be offering courses this fall semester. Hallelujah. Registration is going on now. It will be for one more week. Classes will begin on the 21st of September. Go to our webpage and there look at our course offerings and register and even make your payment all online. The address is ccbinyc.org. Again, that is ccbinyc.org. And may the Lord bless you. Look to see you in class this fall in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Our praise team will bless us with a selection in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And the next voice you will hear following our choir will be that of our speaker for this Lord's Day, Bishop William Wilkins Jr., our assistant pastor. Our praise team.
Come on, praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody, for this is the day the Lord has made, and let us rejoice and be glad in it. Anybody just excited about the glory of God? Listen, the song simply says, my hallelujah belongs to you. Yes, it does. My hallelujah belongs to you. My hallelujah belongs to you, oh Lord. My hallelujah belongs to you. And why is that? Because you deserve praise. to sing it, yeah.
Hallelujah.
It belongs to you. God, you're deserving of all the praise, all the glory, all the honor. My hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
It belongs to you.
Bless you. Thank you, praise team, for that beautiful selection. We praise and thank God for you in the name of Jesus Christ. Certainly, we do honor the Spirit of God that is here with us today, and we praise and thank God because God is so good to us. His mercy is everlasting, and his truth endures to all generations. We praise and thank God for all that we have experienced, and even though everything may not be the way that we want it to be, but God is a good God, and he's worthy to be praised. Certainly we do honor our pastor, Bishop Charles Wright Sr., and we praise and thank God and salute him and his lovely wife, Mother Wright, and we praise and thank God for my wife, Sister Sarah, and to all whom honors due, and to Minister Ernest Billups, and all of God's people, and each of you who are viewing us via the way of live streaming. We ask that you now go to us to the Word of God as we share for a few moments what we believe the Lord would have for us to say. We're in Philippians chapter number 3, very familiar passage of Scripture, and it reads on this wise, that I may know him, verse number 10, and the power of his resurrection, and the fellowship of his suffering, being made conformable unto death, if by any means I might obtain unto the resurrection of the dead, not as though I had already attained, either were already perfect, but I follow after, if that I may apprehend that which also I am apprehended of Christ Jesus. Verse number 13, brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press toward the mark of the prize, the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. I want to take my thought this morning, and if you pray with us for the moments that we have left, from the verse number 10, the first five words in verse number 10, that I may know him. This epistle, was written by the Apostle Paul. And this is one of the prison epistles, along with Ephesians, Colossians, and Philemon. And it was written the origin of it being written in Acts chapter number 28. It was written around 49 AD. And one of the things that we do know is that the Apostle Paul, during his second missionary journey, was traveling with Timothy, and the Lord showed him a vision, and this church would begin. The epistle that we are reading from today speaks to us from a historical perspective, if you will. Epaphroditus, who is one of the leaders of the church, word had gotten to the church that their pastor, Pastor Paul, was in trouble. And this church loved their pastor, and so they sent him to go and check on Pastor Paul. And so he travels 800 miles, and as he travels the 800 miles, amen, he finds the Apostle Paul there in a Roman jail, chained. He begins to share with the Apostle Paul three important things. He shares with him that this church loved their pastor, Apostle Paul. They also brought him a financial gift. He also updated him on what was actually happening in the church and some of the challenges of the church. And so the Apostle Paul begins to write to them, and this epistle is a response to that. And so you'll see questions answered, and you will see his response to his visit from Epaphroditus. And so You'll see in, first he wants to thank them for the gift, and you'll see that in chapter number 4. And then he updates them regarding the comfort of his situation, that he's comforted even in his situation, in chapter number 1. And also in chapter number 2, he begins to give, in chapter number 2 through chapter number 4, he begins to give pastoral counsel to them regarding their walk with Christ and the importance of, for them to continue in the faith. He also shares with them his love in chapter number 4, and he solicits their prayers. This epistle is known to us as an important epistle, and it's important because it is important to know that the thought in the epistle is a thought of rejoicing and joy. One of the key words that you'll see constantly in this epistle is joy. You'll see it, amen, several times in this epistle, the word rejoice or joy, some 16 times in this epistle. And you'll see the apostle, even though his situation is some would say an emergency or perhaps even challenging, but yet even in the most challenging times, he makes up in his mind that he will rejoice. Man, throughout chapter number 1 and chapter number 2, he begins to explain to them and begins to thank God for them and their faithfulness in the Lord. This was a faithful church, faithful believers, faithful folk. They were committed to the cause. And the Apostle Paul thanks them for their faithfulness. And he also shares with them his love and his prayers. But in chapter number 3, he begins to address three important things that he wants them to know. He wants them first to know that they need to beware of those who have crept in and those whose intention is to turn their hearts away from the true gospel. He also, in verse number 4 through 6, shares his testimony. In verses 7 through 14, begins to talk to them about his focus. Well, he shares with them, again, first, this idea of a warning to be careful of dogs, beware of dogs. And what he is referring to is evil workers who were coming, and after Paul would preach and teach and share, they had a tendency to try to tell them that salvation and receiving the gift of the Holy Ghost was not enough. They would begin to say things to them and begin to share with them the fact that perhaps they needed to do more, that they needed to be circumcised, they needed to follow the law, the Holy Spirit was not enough. And Paul begins to share with them the importance of them to be careful of people who are trying to give you something, amen, that is not necessary. So he wants to share with them, be careful of Judaizers who would creep in. He refers to them as evil workers, dogs. He refers to them as individuals who had the wrong spirit. So just like now in the world that we live in the challenges that we face, there are so many people around us who would try to pervert the gospel of Jesus Christ and tell you that your salvation, the gift of the Holy Ghost, is not enough. Perhaps you need to do more. Certainly, we know that we need to live a sanctified life, but Jesus completed the work of salvation on Calvary's cross. When he gave us the Comforter, for those of us who have received the gift of the Holy Spirit with the evidence of speaking in tongues, he gave us everything that we need. And I praise and thank God for the gift of the Holy Ghost today. I don't know about you, but I praise and thank God that the Holy Ghost is enough. Not only is the Holy Ghost is enough, it's more than enough. I praise and thank God, amen, that at the age of 10 years old, the Lord Jesus Christ filled me with the gift of the Holy Ghost. Apostle Paul, amen, wants them to understand that their hope must be built on what they know about Jesus Christ. He wants them to understand that they should have no confidence in their own flesh, in their own abilities, in their own accomplishments, if you will. He wants them to understand that if anyone had an opportunity to boast, he could certainly boast because he had a lot to boast about. And so the Apostle Paul, not bragging, but shares with them that if there's any need for boasting, he would have a need to boast. So he tells them, he says in chapter number 3 and verse number 5, that he was circumcised on the 8th day. His parents followed the law, and to the T, he did. From a very young child, 8 days old, he was circumcised. And he was also of the stock of Israel. He was a pure-blooded citizen of Israel, which meaning that he wasn't mixed with anything else. He was a pure-blooded citizen of Israel. Not only that, he also shares with them that he was a member of the tribe of Benjamin. And so this was something that he could certainly boast about, a well-known tribe. Amen. He also shares with them that he was a member of the Pharisees, who demanded strictness and obedience to the law. Verse number 6, he also talks about his zealousness. Amen. And how he looked back over his own life and talked about how harsh he was, and even in his persecution of Christians. But the Apostle Paul wants them to know that none of those things are important. And I think that it's important for us to understand that, because too many of us think that our schools, the school that we go to, is important. Perhaps we think the title that we have is important. Perhaps we think, amen, our education or position or our money is important. But the Apostle Paul wants them to understand is that all of those things are of little value in the kingdom of God, in the economy of God, amen, in the kingdom of God, those things mean nothing at all. And certainly we spend all of our lives trying to accomplish things, and sometimes in our thrive and in our thrust to accomplish many things, we forget about the Lord Jesus Christ. We forget about him being the author and the finisher of our faith. I don't know about you, beloved of God, and those of you who are listening and watching today, I want you to know that it's important to have the Lord Jesus Christ in your life. Have him in your life moving. Have him in your life. Amen. The fellowship with the Lord Jesus Christ. It's urgent. It's important. Amen. Paul says none of those things are important as knowing God. And I know that we take pride in the schools that perhaps we have gone to. We've all been to secular schools and even religious schools, and all of those things are great in itself. But those things don't necessarily bring you closer to God. It's all about knowing him. And when Paul speaks about knowing God, he speaks about this experiential know, a knowing that only comes from time and experience with the Lord Jesus Christ. One songwriter said, every day with Jesus is sweeter than the day before. Every day with him, I love him more and more. Jesus saves and keeps me. He's the one that I adore, and every day with him is sweeter than the day before. Knowing God is important. The Apostle Paul says, all of my accomplishments, everything, all of the status that I was born with. The Apostle Paul sat at the feet of Gamaliel, a man who was a key leader of that day, who had plenty of knowledge, but yet, the Apostle Paul says, none of that is important as a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ and knowing Jesus Christ. And I've come to tell you today, it's important that you get to know the Lord Jesus Christ. I know that you may not feel that it's important because you know, amen, perhaps the mayor, perhaps you know the president, perhaps you know the pastor, the assistant pastor, the missionary. All of those things are good, but none of those things replace, amen, knowing the Lord Jesus Christ. The Apostle Paul says in verse number 8, he says, I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus, my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things and do count them as dung that I may win Christ. And so what the Apostle Paul is saying here is that all of the things that I have accomplished, I count them as loss. I'm willing to give up every aspect of my life for a true relationship with God. And I would like to share with you today, precious child of God, that many of us can't get close to Christ because we're not willing to give up some things. But if you're going to serve God, there are some things that you are just simply going to have to walk away from. There are some things that you're going to have to count as loss. Amen. They become burdens. They become heavy weights. Amen. They become things that hold you back from your true experience with the Lord Jesus Christ. And I don't know about you today, but I believe that God is calling us to a higher place of praise. Place of knowing God in a unique way. Listen to these words, amen, from the New Living Translation, that same verse. It says, yes, everything else is worthless when compared with the infinite value of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. For his sake, I have discarded everything else. Count it all as garbage so that I can gain Christ. Glory be to God. Now, I don't know about you, but I am on a pursuit to know God. To know him, amen, in a new and exciting way. To go higher and higher and higher heights and deeper depths. So he says, I count it all as loss. Verse number 9, amen, he says, and to be found in him. And I don't know about you, but I want to be found in him. And I've come to tell you today, this is no time to play church. This is a time now to get right with God and do it now. This is no time, amen, for us to be straddling the fence. It's time for the true child of God and the true Christians to say, yes, I'm on the Lord's side. Amen. To be found in him, not having my own righteousness, which is of the law, but which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith. In other words, what the apostle is saying here, and I'll read it to you again from the New Living Translation that helps us out a bit. It says, and to become one with him, I no longer count on my own righteousness through obedience of the law. Rather, I become righteous through faith in Christ. I become everything that I need to be in Jesus Christ. And I've come to ask you a question today as you sit in front of your, amen, computer or in front of your phone or however you're watching us today. My question to you is, what are you willing to give up so that you can have the relationship that you need with the Lord Jesus Christ? Look at verse number 10. Verse number 10 says that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his suffering, being made conformed unto his death. knowing him from experience. Knowing him from experience is important. I would like to suggest to you, when you go to court, amen, the judge only wants to hear what you have seen, what you have experienced, or what you have heard firsthand. The judge wants to know what you know. And today, I've come to tell you today that if you're going to have a true relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, amen, if you're going to have a relationship with him that is not dependent upon the testimonies of someone else, you've got to know him. Judge doesn't want to know anything else because everything else is hearsay. The judge wants to know what you know. I heard somebody say, what you know about Jesus? And I heard the response come back, say, he's all right. Glory be to God. Amen. Not only do I want to know him, I want to know him, amen, in the power of his resurrection. The Holy Ghost comes with power. The Holy Ghost comes with power. The power that makes you, amen, walk uprightly before him. The power, amen, that gives you the victory over sin. Power that gives you victory over lust. Power that gives you victory over every devil in hell. Power that gives you victory over temptations. Power that gives you victory to be bold in the Lord Jesus Christ. That's the power that we have dwelling within us when we receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. And I don't know about you today, but God is calling for folks to have power. Amen. And there's power that we get through the work of the Lord Jesus Christ, the finished work of the Lord Jesus Christ. But the Apostle Paul says in verse number 10, that I may know him, the power of his resurrection, and in the fellowship of his suffering, being made conformable until his death. Amen. And so we don't mind having the power of his resurrection, but the latter part of the text most of us struggle with. We struggle with the issue of the fellowship of his suffering. Glory be to God, suffering with the Lord Jesus Christ. Even if it causes you pain, I've got to know him. Even if it suffers loss, I've got to know him. Even if it causes us something, I've got to know him. I want to know him. Glory be to God. So that's what I'm striving for. The Apostle Paul, amen, lets us know in the text the importance, even while he is in chains. He wants them to know that, yes, I'm in chains, but I'm learning God on a whole nother level. The experiences that I am having with the Lord Jesus Christ, even in these chains, is making me, amen, conformable. It is pulling me. It is stretching me. It is giving me the ability, amen, to have more power and more victory and more anointing because of my suffering. And I've come to tell someone today that I know it may not feel like it, but God is on your side. Even though it may seem like God is forgotten about you, but God is on your side. He promised that he would never leave you nor forsake you. He promised that he would be with you always, even to the end of the age. And I know that you're experiencing some pains right now. But when I was a little boy, I was having some muscle pain, and mama took me to the doctor. And the doctor said, he's all right. He's just having what we call growing pains. And sometimes God allows you to feel the pain of spiritual elevation. God allows you to feel the hurt and the agony of disappointment and sorrow. But now we live in a day and time and a society that don't want to go through anything. We want to miss the steps of elevation and have the elevation without going through the steps. But I've come to tell you today that if you're going to know God, I'm not talking about knowing the pastor. I'm not talking about knowing the assistant pastor, but I'm talking about knowing God. If you're going to know God, it means that you're going to have to go through some things. Yes, Lord, I heard one songwriter say, trouble in my way. I may have to cry sometimes. I know you have shed some tears as you've been walking out this thing with God. But that's all right, because Jesus has promised to fix it after a while. And I come to tell you, he may not come when you want him, but he'll be on time. And I want you to know that if you're going to know God, you're going to have to take a licking and keep on ticking. You're going to have to learn that if God be for you, who can be against you? You're going to have to stand on the word of God that no weapon that is formed against me will prosper. You've got to tell every devil in hell that I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. Glory be to God. I came in your living room, hallelujah, on this morning to tell you, beloved, go through. But when you go through, you gotta be like David and let the devil know, though I go, through the valley of the shadows of death, I fear no evil, for thou art with me. The rod and thy staff, it does comfort me. And God said, don't worry about your enemies, because I prepare a table before you in the presence of your enemies. And while you're going through it, he said, I'm going to let your cup run over, and I'll anoint your head with oil. Surely, yeah, Lord, goodness will be on one side, mercy will be on the other side. Surely, he won't leave me. Surely, he won't forsake me. I don't know who I'm talking to, but onward, Christian soldier. Fight on, Christian. Your time ain't long. Fight on, Christian. Your time ain't long. Go through. Yes, Lord. And the apostle said, he said, wait a minute. He said, as a matter of fact, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching to those things which are before. Press. And I come to tell somebody, don't lose your press. Don't lose your press if you gotta crawl your way through. Don't lose your press if you gotta walk by yourself. Don't lose your press if they lie on you. Don't lose your press if they talk about you. That's all right. Tell yourself, that's all right. Hallelujah. Because he promised never to leave me. Yes, Lord. And I know, I got an experiential know, that if he did it before, if he did it before, he'll do it again. When you touch yourself and say, self, if he did it before, he'll do it again. That's why, don't lose your testimony. Don't lose your testimony. Keep your testimony. Let every devil in hell know that I serve a risen Savior. And that's why I'm not going to wait till the battle is over. I'm
going to shout now. That's why I can shout and give God praise while I'm going through. That's why I've learned how to bless the Lord. Yeah, at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. I got to praise on the inside, and I got to get it out. I dare you, right where you are, stand up on your feet and begin to praise God. Put your foot up. Put your foot down. Give God the best praise you got. Keep on pressing. Hallelujah. Press beyond your situation. Press. Oh, yes. Glory be to God. I know. We don't like to hear messages like this because we want to believe that all we have to do is, as our pastor says, name it and claim it and grab it and blab it. And that would be nice if things work that way. But you've got to go through the process of knowing him so that you can reach the point where you can say, I know him for myself. And I don't need the testimonies of anyone else. One songwriter said, when I look back over my life and I think things over, I can truly say that I have been blessed because I've got a testimony. God is building your testimony. He's building your experience. He's building. He wants you to know him. Paul says that I may know him. I've been to the best schools. I know protocol, I know the law. I know, amen, everything because I was a Pharisee myself, but yet I count it all as dung, loss, garbage, so that I can know him. I want to know him. Not church protocol, not what people want you to know around you, not Christian culture, but I need to know him. I want to know him. Do you want to know him? Perhaps while you're in your house, I am thine, O Lord. I have heard thy voice, and it showed thy love for thee. Draw me nearer, nearer, blessed Lord.